Are you all able to hear me right all the way up to the end? Yes? Please raise your hand if you can hear me. Okay, great. All right. So, yes. You know, I get confused even in restaurants. I take other people's plates, I take their glasses. I can never tell which fork belongs to whom. And I'm doing this with microphones as well. So welcome everybody. Adab arze. I'm very happy to welcome you to this very, very interesting session, Hamari Awaaz, Hamare Alfaaz, which has given me an opportunity to learn a lot, and a lot that is new about my fellow participants here. So let me first introduce to you the members of the panel, and some of these are new and emerging voices. Some of these would be familiar to you and have been around for a long time. But let's see what they have to do in combination with each other and what kind of questions does this combination throw up. So I have here to my left, Sudipti. Sudipti has an M.Phil. She has worked on modernist poets, Mahesh Narayan. She looks at mythology. She looks at issues of contemporary relevance, especially in the field of literature, culture, and gender. And she asks some very, very pointed questions. I found it quite interesting, and maybe we can come back to her later. She believes that a lot of positions on issues of culture tends to become very extremist and very polarized, and she feels that main us tarah ke ativad mein nahi manti, main beech ka rasta leti hu. To hum Sudipti se baad mein itminan se baat karenge ki ye beech ka rasta kya hota hai aur ye beech ka rasta hamesha lazim hota hai ki nahi hota ya kabhi kabhar aapko ativad ki taraf bhi jana padta hai. To iske bare hum fir baad mein baat karenge, lekin Sudipti ka kaam aadhunik kavita pe hai aur mythology pe hai aur in sawalon ko lekar mythology aur aadhunik एक दूसरे से किस तरह से बातचीत करते हैं आपके काम में हम आपसे बाद में सुनेंगे. I also have to my left, immediate left here, Paramita Sathpathy, who's in the administrative service in Orissa, who works with taxation revenue, right? Yeah. And she writes short stories, and she's been writing novels, and there's a range of work that she's engaged in. She's also a very bilingual person. She writes her non-fiction pieces in Hindi and some in English and some in Odia. And she has also been the recipient of the Sahitya Akademi Award. So we will go to Paramita as to what has been her engagement. Interestingly, like Sudipti, she also looks at mythology. And we must ask ourselves as to what is it about mythology that an Amish Tripathi wants to go and a Devdutt Patnaik wants to go, but what happens when women writers also want to go to mythology, and what are some of the spin-offs and what are some of the reinterpretations that they engage in. I have a very old acquaintance and friend, not old in terms of age, but someone whom I have known for a long time. I have Rakhshanda Jalil, who's been like a fellow traveler. She has enormous engagement with the Urdu public sphere as a writer, translator, as someone who works with the Urdu language, also as an activist. And if you see some very, very sophisticated translations from Urdu, please shut your eyes. It was usually Rakhshanda Jalil. Yeah. So I'm very happy to have the panelists with me here. Now, a panel that is called Hamari Awaaz, Hamare Alfaaz, and it only has women. No guesses there as to what are some of the things it's likely to do, right? Maybe I should be sort of asking in this completely, what shall I say, earnest voice to my fellow colleagues and say, लेकिन आप जब लिखने लगीं तो आपको कौन सी तकलीफें हुई? You know, as a woman writer, what problems did you face? And chances are that they would have faced some. But I would rather those things unfold themselves in the course of the panel rather than for them to be put out there immediately. At the moment, I think it's important for us to hear from each of our panelists as to what do they really do, because my introduction has not done justice to the multiple things that they do. So I would like each of them to talk about the journey they have made up to this point. Where did they start? And what kind of engagement they have with the literary world here. Rakhshanda, we will start with you.
Okay. Well, I'm certainly happy to see men in this audience. They kind of hopefully will make up for the absence of men in this panel here, as you rightly say. It worries me that when we put women together on a panel, we seem to assume that they are writing about women, and therefore what they're writing about should be of interest to women only. That, to my mind, is kind of absurd. It would be like Dalit writing is about Dalits, by Dalits, for Dalits, or Black American writing is of interest only to Black Americans and not the others. I mean, so this sort of notion that people seem to have that women writers should be writing about women or are writing about women or are only interested in women doesn't seem to make much sense. Having said that, I have looked critically at women. I've written a biography of Dr. Rashid Jahan. I've put together various anthologies where women have figured in one way or the other. But that doesn't mean that I look at a world through a monochromatic lens, that I'm more interested in women. And I think that brings us to a related issue. Maybe we can pick it up later, this whole notion of feminism. Feminism doesn't mean that you are solely interested in women. I think feminism would mean that you are interested in women, in society, what positions they occupy. So that does interest me very much. But what also interests me and what I've been trying to do for the past 15 years in the context of Urdu is programming. Those who stumble over script, those who stumble over vocabulary, but are nevertheless interested in Urdu, in its literary culture. All languages, as you know, have literary cultures. And those who are interested in Urdu and its larger literary culture, I try and make available for them programs in mainstream spaces. It could be through readings, it could be through dramatic readings of, let's say, a short story. It could be through recitations, dastan goi, mushaira, what have you. So I think all of that kind of comes together with my interest in Urdu, but in a larger context.
I think we will come back to the question of Urdu and Hindi and Odia and English. And maybe if there is an opportunity, I'll talk about the work I do with the languages that I work with. But we'll hang on to that. We'll come to that in a bit. Paramita, if you can tell us a little about your journey as a writer and what kind of writing you do. And where you are currently. Have I taken your mic? No.
Good afternoon, everybody. I have been writing for past 27 years, published few books of novels and stories. And writing has come to me very naturally, I must tell you, because my parents were a writer. My mother is a very important poet of the language. And I would not say that I have never looked at the causes of women. Rather, I must tell you that, I must admit that most of the protagonists in my stories are women, but not because I wanted to show their supremacy or fight against the other persons in the world, but they came to me very naturally. Because I thought that, as a writer, you are always affected by something in the society which is in a little unprivileged place. So underprivileged characters like maybe it is men, women, they have come to my writing. So the book that you had mentioned got Sahitya Akademi Award. That is Gain, Prapti is its name. It's a collection of 10 novellas, a journey of women at different strata, different situation, different kinds. Then I have written a novel very strangely based on the period from 1920 to 1947. That is the pre-independence period. Just, you are waiting for getting independence and there is still some blocks in between. So that was the period I had taken and that has been written. And currently, as you have told, you are sharing with us that I have been writing I've taken some women characters from mythology and also some modern women in the same situation. So I'm writing series or episodes on each of them.
We'll come to that, I think I'll turn over to Sudipti. And Sudipti, is it possible for you to talk a little about Mahesh Narayan and what made you, what drew you to him and to Swapna? Is that, can you talk about that?
मैंने जब जब मैं एमए कर रही थी उन दिनों बहुत सारा ऐसा
अच्छा आपको सुनाई दे रहा है सबको ठीक है
बहुत सारी ऐसी चर्चाएं होती थी कि हिंदी की पहली कहानी कौन सी है कौन सा उपन्यास है लेकिन ऐसा जिक्र नहीं होता था कि हिंदी की पहली आधुनिक कविता कौन सी है क्योंकि लोग ये मान के चलते थे कि जब आधुनिकता हिंदी समाज में या हमारे इस उत्तर भारतीय समाज में आ रही थी उस पूरे दौरान में लोग ब्रज भाषा में कविता लिख रहे थे और भारत हिंदी में या हमारे समाज में ये मूर्ति पूजा की परंपरा बहुत है कि एक व्यक्ति को बहुत महान बना दिया तो उसके कामों पर हम क्वेश्चन नहीं कर सकते अगर हम मानते हैं कि भारतेंदु जो हैं वो हिंदी में आधुनिकता लेके आए तो कैसे क्वेश्चन करें कि कोई और आधुनिक कविता लिख सकता है तो ये सारे सवाल आए फिर ऐसा नहीं है कि मैं कहूँगी कि मैं ही जाकर इस कविता को ढूंढ लाई
आप आधुनिकता किस चीज़ को कहती हैं आप
जो हमारे समाज में औद्योगिकरण के द्वारा जो बदलाव हुए जो स्वतंत्रता आई और अपनी आइडेंटिटी की पहचान हुई या जो सवाल करने की पद्धति आई उससे आधुनिकता को हम जोड़ते हैं और हिंदी भाषा जो अभी हम खड़ी बोली हिंदी देखते हैं उसमें अगर लिखी हुई कविता है तो उसको हम उसको क्योंकि कहानियों में जब हम भाषा पर बात करते हैं तो हम ब्रज भाषा या अवधि में लिखी हुई कहानियों की बात नहीं करते हैं हम खड़ी बोली हिंदी में लिखी कहानियों पर बात करते हैं तो भाषा के स्तर पर और उसमें विचारों के स्तर पर तो यह एक लंबी कविता स्वप्न नाम से जो महेश नारायण ने धारावाहिक रूप से सीरियल पोएट मतलब कहानियाँ तो सीरियल के तो तरह से एपिसोड्स में आती हैं लेकिन कविता जो है इस तरह से पहली बार मेरी नज़र में आई बिहार बंधु नामक एक अखबार आता था उसमें लगभग एक दशक तक इनकी कविताएं बीच बीच में छपी रुकी और यह 33 हिस्सों में बटी हुई कविता है और सबसे मज़ेदार है कि यह एक स्त्री के नज़रिए से लिखी हुई है स्वप्न में जो फैंटेसी रची गई है वह चंद्रमा की है और चंद्रमा में वह स्त्री जो है कोई किसी से प्रेम करती है तो उसका पिता उस पर बहुत नाराज़ होता है उसका विवाह कर देता है किसी ऐसे व्यक्ति से जो बहुत वृद्ध है और जो हमारे समाज में तब बहुत हो रहा था और उसको उठाकर धरती पर फेंक देता है यहाँ वो आती है और यहाँ के हालात देखकर सवाल करती है बहुत सारे जिसमें है कि क्या मेरे यहाँ तो आज़ादी नहीं है यहाँ तो आज़ादी होगी यहाँ तो अखबार जो हैं वो स्वतंत्र होंगे उसमें स्वाधीनता की बात है ये स्वतंत्रता की बात है ये और वह एक स्त्री जो है किसी और जगह से उठाकर कहीं और फेंक दी जाती है वो बात करती है तो ये मुझे बहुत दिलचस्प लगा और इसके बारे में मैंने
ठीक है उसी से आगे बढ़ते हुए सवाल ये है कि अगर महेश नारायण जो एक मेल राइटर हैं लेकिन इस तरह से एक संवेदना से वो स्वप्न में लिख रहे हैं किसी औरतों के बारे में या रक्षंदा जैसे आप बता रही है दैट आई एम नॉट कन्फाइंड एज अ वूमन ट्रांसलेटर और अ वूमन क्रिटिक और अ वूमन राइटर टू ओनली डील विद विमेन कैरेक्टर्स whereas Paramita has made it quite clear that she sees a gender imbalance and she sees forms of, you know, underprivilege and marginalization in women. So she prefers to deal with women characters. I think let's ask ourselves this question here as to who can write about whom with greatest justice? And what does justice mean? हम किस चीज़ के साथ न्याय कर सकते हैं किसके बारे में हम बिल्कुल न्यायपूर्वक हम लिख सकते हैं क्या उसकी कोई ऐसी मायने होती हैं कि उसका रिश्ता किसी वर्ग से किसी जाति से किसी किसी धर्म से किसी मज़हब से या किसी जेंडर से होता है या एक तरह की सिर्फ कमिटमेंट होती है इज़ देयर ओनली अ कमिटमेंट टू रिप्रेजेंटेशन टू पोर्ट्रेयल टू a world of words and a world of imagination that characterizes what we want to do with it or is it that we can only do justice if we are situated sociologically in a particular caste religion gender and so on so I'm asking all of you to respond but I'd appreciate it if you respond briefly because I want to build up from there
I think justice comes from empathy and I'm not for a minute suggesting that male writers cannot have empathy about a woman or about a woman as a subject. In Urdu and in Hindi, we've always had a very long tradition of men writing in a woman's voice. It could be through the Baramasa, where poets in Gujarati, in Rajasthani, in Hindi, yeah, in Urdu have always been writing. The notion of Virah, for example, the Virahini. This has been the agony and the angst of the Virahini has been portrayed very poetically by male writers. So I'm not suggesting that. But there is a world of a difference between that sort of a fake cosmetic voice that the male writers had adopted. And by the time you come to the 21st century, by the time, even the late 20th century, you begin to see a change. You begin to see that change from Premchand when he's talking about unequal marriages, older men marrying very young women, and so on. And by the time you come to Manto, by the time you come to Krishan Chandar, you see that empathy sharpening. So in a word, if you were to ask me, what is it that qualifies a writer, male or woman, to talk about inequality, and it could not, it need not be gender. I am happier if I find a writer who's looking at inequality through the prism of class and caste. You know, and within that, yes, within the prism of class inequality, if you are able to pinpoint that women are the greater sufferers, I'm buying that argument too, right? Mm. And then you have women writers, a remarkable pioneering kind of woman writer in Urdu, a woman who's very seldom talked about, Dr. Rashid Jahan, you know, who's writing about class, who's writing about gender, who's writing about poverty, who's writing about exploitation, and she's mixing in many issues. Nationalism, anti-colonialism, all of these issues are coming together in her stories, which are one of a kind, and I think we need to go back to these other
pioneering. Do you want to talk about Ismat here? That might be quite appropriate.
I want to talk about Ismat because actually Rashid Jahan is a precursor to Ismat. It is people like Rashid Jahan who are opening a window for Ismat to find her raw material. So you have a language being used as a literary device. The language that was being spoken by women in the privacy of their homes, a language which was distinct from the language that men were using outside, in the outside world. This language would be called Begmati Zuban. And Ismat is very cleverly turning this into a literary device. In her hands, language becomes a tool. She gives agency to it, to use a more sort of modern expression for something that Ismat was doing very naturally, very organically. Here is somebody who's making the personal political. It is a slogan that came out of the feminist movement, and I don't think Ismat was aware of its political implications, but nevertheless, people like Ismat, when they talk about the small personal inequalities, injustices, they make the personal political.
So I'll come back to you this question on suffering versus desire. I think, you know, while you might find male writers making an empathetic entry into the world of suffering, yeah, Maithili Sharan Gupta is doing it, Mahesh Narayan is doing it, but
even
I feel
Premchand,
like
Premchand is doing it.
But I think it's sort of, they become stories of pain and agony and suffering. I would be interested in seeing whether there are male writers who talk about women's desires. But maybe we can come to that a little later. Paramita, would you like to step in now?
Yeah, I actually believe that a writer is genderless. You know,
gender?
Genderless. You know, there
genderless.
Is no gender for a writer. Because, you know, like we adopt a gender of the character. I do that when I write. And as far as men writing on women, we, in my own language, there are so many good pieces. I will cite, you know, in the Riti Yug, the Riti era of poetry, when it was basically the poets were writing the love poem, love between Radha and Krishna. There are few poets of my language, that is Odia. They have written beautiful pieces of Radha desiring Krishna. And if there are literature lovers before me, and probably you must have read the poetry of our time, Sri Radha by Ramakant Rath. At least Rita and Rakshada, you must have read, you must have read. So here, you know, it's not a desire of Radha for Krishna, but Radha's own philosophy, her life philosophy has been so nicely depicted by Ramakant Rath. So it's not that a male writer cannot write or would not give that much justice to writing about the real mind of a woman, but what in my own novel also, in the novel that I've written.
Paramita, before you go to your work, I think I'll just stay with Radha for a moment. And it seems to me, I'm feeling a little reluctant actually to agree with you very easily here. Like I feel, you know, to talk about Radha's longing for Krishna only enhances the greatness of Krishna. But if you're talking about the desire and longing and sexuality of a woman in your life or someone in your office or someone around, and you feel empathetic about the fact that this woman has not had a chance, and as a male writer you talk about that, I think it's a different situation.
There
is a tradition of desire and longing of Radha and Krishna.
But that's actually available in folk. Let's not disregard the folk tradition. The folk tradition that way is much more comfortable with fairly natural things, whether it is Baramasa, Biraha poetry, all of that or just large parts of folk poetry, use this much more naturally.
Even in Sri Radha by Ramakant Rath, it is not desire of Radha only. It's a whole life philosophy of Radha.
Yeah.
You know, what Radha stands for and what has been her conviction, how she carried herself, what she had not gone after Krishna when that's altogether a different poem, and it's a poem is not a single poem, it's a kavya. It's a, you know, poem, 40-50 poems together. So it actually discusses Radha's life. Radha as a human being, as a woman, as a person of a great philosophy. Yeah. So that is what I wanted
to say. Sudipti, do you want to step in?
Yes. जैसे पारमिता राधा के बारे में कह रही थी, तो जब हम हिंदी को देखते हैं, या मैं हिंदी के अलावा और भी भक्तिकालीन कविताओं को देखती हूँ, तो जैसे आम तौर पर जो पुरुष कवि हैं, वो राधा और कृष्ण के प्रेम की बात करते हैं, लेकिन हम मीरा को देखें तो वो कृष्ण के प्रति अपने प्रेम का निवेदन करती हैं, या आंडाल को देखें तो वो विष्णु के प्रति अपने प्रेम का, और काफ़ी उसमें मानसल वर्णन है. ऐसा नहीं शरीर नहीं आता, ऐसा नहीं कि वो सिर्फ दैवीय प्रेम है, या अक्का का जो शिव के लिए लिखे हुए पद हैं, तो वो सारी चीज़ें जहाँ स्त्री अपनी इच्छाएं, चाहे वो शारीरिक दैहिक इच्छाएं भी हैं, वो ईश्वर के प्रति अर्पित करती है, तो उसका कहीं ना कहीं एक संबंध है कि वो सामान्य तरीके से नहीं कर पा रही है, शायद वो स्वीकृति है कि वो ईश्वर के लिए कर रही है. तो और जो आपने शुरू में बात कही थी कि क्या जो स्वयं भोग रहा है वही उसका लिख सकता है, तो हिंदी में तो बहुत इस पर काफ़ी हमारी लेखिकाएं हैं, कृष्णा जी, मनु जी, उन्होंने तो हमेशा कहा है कि स्त्री लेखन और पुरुष लेखन ऐसा कुछ नहीं है, और हम लेखक हैं. और
आप भी यही मानती हैं?
मैं अपनी बात कह रही हूँ कि मैं एक आलोचक की तरह से देखती हूँ कि जब मनु जी महाभोज लिखती हैं, और वह एक बहुत राजनीतिक किताब है, इतनी उत्तर भारत की राजनीति, जातिगत राजनीति और जो संहार है वो इसमें इस कदर उभर के आता है कि लोग उसको पढ़ते हुए अचानक से यकीन नहीं कर पाते कि किसी स्त्री ने लिखी. तो क्यों नहीं कर पाते? क्योंकि उनके दिमाग में है कि ये स्त्री नहीं लिख सकती. तो ऐसा नहीं है. अब जब कृष्णा सोपती मित्रों मरजानी लिखती हैं, तो मैं देखती हूँ कि अगर वह कोई पुरुष लिखता और मित्रों को वैसा देखता, तो शायद वो स्त्री की आज़ादी की कहानी ना होकर ऐसे हो जाता कि स्त्री को नीचा दिखाया जा रहा है, क्योंकि वो अपनी दैहिक इच्छाओं के लिए बहुत जागरूक है और बहुत सारी चीज़ें तोड़ती है, बहुत सारी रूढ़ियों को. वो हमारे ऐसे ही होनी चाहिए स्त्री, वैसे नहीं. तब पुरुष लिखता तो शायद वो शायद अपनी बात कहना आसान हो जाता है सवालों के घेरे में आने से, क्योंकि अगर कोई पुरुष लिखता तो शायद हम उसको सोचते कि ये स्त्री द्वेष में भी लिख रहा है.
If you will allow me to jump in for just a minute,
sure, please.
I want to point out that there's a time and circumstance for everything. I think society now is that much more open. The mystique of the zanana is not really there. So there was a time when women were within the family, within the domestic realm, living sequestered lives. They were certainly not out in the open. They were not seen on the streets. There was no notion of workplace. So it's not as though you had colleagues who were women. So I think there was a whole generation of writers who were writing about women with a sense of mystique, of awe, of wonder. This is another species altogether. I think that awe, that sense of, okay,
yeah,
who
yeah.
are these people? What kind of lives do they live? I think that is no longer an issue. Men have women as colleagues, as friends, as neighbors. And I think that my sense is that they are beginning to see them as people. Hmm. Right? And we begin to see this change from the 1930s. There was a time when women needed to write in a certain way. You see, they were writing in that way because nobody else was writing. Nobody else had access. So when Rashid Jaha is writing a play called Parde Ke Piche, she had testimony to it. She was bringing something out from behind the curtain and making it public. Because men didn't have access. She, as a doctor, as a woman who bridged both worlds, as a new breed of a working woman, as a woman doctor, had access to the sequestered lives of the women.
Very
so she's able to talk about things that the men couldn't have dreamt about. Let me give you a very gory example and I'll rest my case. In Parde Ke Piche, a play, Rashid Jaha is written like a conversation between two women. And one woman is telling her older friend and confidant how she got her womb fixed. This is written in 1932. She got her womb fixed so that she can give greater pleasure to her husband. Do you think men knew about these things? Do you think men could write about these things? So here is an instance. This is Parde Ke Piche, a play that appears in a collection called Angare in 1932.
Of course, absolutely.
Of course, it's banned, but that's another matter.
Right, right, right.
But the content is such.
Yeah.
And it's about access. It's about being there by knowing those things.
Yeah.
Which doesn't apply now.
And that also actually brings us, it sort of signals to that question I was trying to ask Sudipti earlier, which is that, what is modernity? Right? Whether we see that as a temporal phenomenon or whether we see that as a particular kind of treatment. I think Angare is a great example of that. I think for a moment, I do want to confess that there's something making me uncomfortable, and I think I'm equally a participant in that, that we have turned, the discussion is very binary, right? About male, female. Maybe we might want to look at sexuality, sexual orientation, along a spectrum.
But why just sexuality, Rita? Do you think women don't write on politics? Do you think they don't write about world affairs?
No. They will, and we are coming to that. I think all I'm saying is that in the repeated sort of discussion all of us are having about men, women, I think I do want to remind ourselves that there are also sexualities which are along the spectrum, and we might want to keep that in mind, whether they figure in your work in direct or indirect ways or not. Maybe you can talk about that later. Or if you already have them, maybe you can talk about that. Whether you've thought about forms of transsexuality or gay, lesbian, LGBT, any of that. Whether these come into the literary realm that you are dealing with. So that we don't sort of keep perpetuating a certain kind of a distinction. So can I have a quick response to that? If maybe Sudipti, would you like to? Are these questions that figure in your work, in the questions, non-fiction articles you are writing?
Not really, but.
और हिंदी में लिखने वाले तो होंगे ही.
मुझे इस subject को हम day-to-day life में deal करते हैं और बहुत सारी छोटी arguments में या discussion में या micro blogging वगैरह में करते हैं लेकिन as a write मतलब इस ये मेरी writing में नहीं है और मुझे लगता है कि जो ये सारा जो setup है जिससे हम चीजों को सही गलत बहुत judgmental तरीके से देखते हैं और इससे दूर हटकर इसको देखने की जरूरत है और अभी एक बहुत बड़ा audience जो है वो इस पर बात करने को ready नहीं है उसको ready करने की जरूरत है बहुत सारी फिल्में या बहुत सारे आर्ट मीडियम ने या आए दिन हो रहे किसी न किसी ऐसे प्रदर्शन ने उसको किया लेकिन मेरी राइटिंग में अभी ऐसा नहीं है
हाँ मैं ये सवाल मैंने सिर्फ इसलिए भी उठाया था कि हम जो ये औरत है ये मर्द है ये जो सवाल जो हम शरीर के साथ जो जुड़ जाते हैं तो उसको हम थोड़ा फ्लूइड तौर पे देखें तो शायद ये हो सकता है कि हमें अपनी ही राइटिंग के बारे में हम कुछ शायद नए ढंग से सोच सकेंगे Very brief response, Paramita.
No, actually, Rita, it's not exactly with the body. There is a mind also. So I have, since I've been writing into mainstream fiction writing for a very long time, so I have written, almost dealt with all kinds of characters and all kinds of subjects. I have dealt with, as you said, transgenders. I have dealt with women's sexuality. I mean, you know, a story of mine, since it's not possible for me to remember each and every that I've written. You know, the male character is asking the woman that, what is this? How do you express this? He says that, you know, wearing a sari or making pakodas for me, for you, is also a kind of expression of my sexuality for you. I mean, this kind of things also I've written. And as far as that you have concerned, that transgender, I have written a story in that the woman is so devoid of touch. The, you know, the protagonist is maybe a... not a very elderly woman, but in her middle age, and she's so devoid of touch that a transgender comes and embraces her, and she feels so good that, do it again, I mean, embrace me again, that she says. So I deal, you know, it's just not with body, but with a little bit of mind and, you know, the psychology and mind involved in it, have been writing
fair.
Quite
yeah,
a
yeah, yeah.
You know, Rita, I've been working on communalism, I've been working on partition, I've been looking at communal violence that unspooled from 1947 and continued to affect our lives in different ways. And I was looking at Urdu literature, and I was, within that, I was also trying to see how women have looked at communalism and how women have looked at communal violence and how it sort of tears up the fabric of life. Mm. I have in mind two examples. One, of course, is Ismat. We think of Ismat as the writer of Lihaf, as the, you know, the LGBT icon. Yeah. But Ismat has written so much else. And Ismat has written, for example, she's written Dhani Baake, which is a very sensitive play on communal violence and how it impacts on women. In a neighborhood when communal violence breaks out, how do women deal with it? Women who've been neighbors, who've been sending achar across to each other and getting papad from the other house, how do they deal with violence? That's a very example, interesting example in mind. Then coming to modern times, I have in mind a writer called Zakia Mashadi, who lives in Patna, who has written this beautiful story called Bhediye Secular Hai. Now, in the hinterland, in a village, bhediyes have been, wolves have been running off with kids. So, ye afwah ho jati hai ke ye bhediya jo hai zarur Hindu hai kyunki ye musalmanon ke bachchon ko sirf utha raha hai. Then one day, Hinduon ke bachche bhi uthaye jane lage. So then they said, okay, it's all right. This bhediya is secular. Because he's indiscriminate in picking up both Hindu and Muslim kids.
Tab love jihad nahi kaha jata tha.
Tab love jihad nahi tha because these were kids. These were infants who
were picked up. Aaj ka love jihad kal ka secular tha.
Secular hai. Right. So now that's what I'm trying to say is, if we were to just step away from this debate of body and sexuality, which is important, but then I think we must also keep in mind that women are creatures of this world, of this society. What concerns men, I think, also concerns women. Yes, they can interpret it differently. They can give it another color. They can have another way of seeing. But that doesn't mean that their concern with the world is any less, or that they are not engaged in the world that they live in.
Yeah. In fact, this is, reminds me of a story I translated from Gujarati, which is called Indu Bhai Gayab. And it's about this large, very larger than life person, like some kind of a political figure, who then one day becomes as small as an ant and then is gobbled up by another large figure, almost to say that power expands in this manner.
Yeah.
And it's a highly sort of a metaphoric, but a highly kind of political story in this collection called Speech and Silence, where I look at a range of women's writing. But that also sort of reminds me that there are things that, whether that is an engagement with the external world, Rakhshanda, as you mentioned, or the worlds that Paramita and Sudipti are mentioning, there are also sometimes worries about whether you have the freedom to write what you want to write. Let's just say if I was writing my book today, I think I would wait for a couple of family members to die before I feel free to write about them. You know what I mean? It's a little, it's There are forms of censorship also that come into play whether you are
आप किताब की बात कर रही हैं. मैं यहाँ एक उदाहरण देना चाहूँगी कि फेसबुक पोस्ट लिखने पे कितनी सारी महिलाएं आकर इनबॉक्स में कहती हैं कि ये हमारी बात है, ये हमारे परिवार की बात है, लेकिन मैं वहाँ कमेंट में भी नहीं कर सकती. हाँ, मेरे मेरे बहुत सारे
मैसेज करती हैं.
बहुत सारे मेरे दोस्त जो हैं वो इस बात पे जो मेरे वेल विशर हैं बहुत नाराज़ होते हैं कि मैं बहुत टाइम उस पर बहुत ज़ाया करती हूँ, बहुत वक्त लगाती हूँ, क्यों मैं उस पर लिखती हूँ इतना. तो लेकिन ये सारे मैसेजेस जो बहुत दूर दूर से औरतें हैं, जो उनकी बहुत छोटी सी समस्या होगी, शायद अपनी फैमिली में अपने पिता के साथ कुछ है जो कि वो किसी को नहीं बता सकती, लेकिन वो आके अपनी बात कहती हैं और शायद कोई मैं उनकी मदद कर सकूं, या उनको ऐसा लगता है कि ये चीज़ जो मेरा अनुभव है या मैं जिस बारे में लिख रही हूँ उससे उनको कुछ मदद मिल जा रही है, तो ये बातें आती हैं इसलिए मैं लिखती हूँ. तो बहुत सारे लोग जब वो एक सोशल मीडिया पे अपने नाम से कमेंट नहीं लिख सकते तो किताब तो बहुत बड़ी बात है कि वो अपनी लिख सकें.
तो ये रिश्ते जो आप बना रही हैं वो फेसबुक के द्वारा हैं कि कोई ब्लॉग है आपका?
नहीं, फेसबुक के द्वारा ही. मैं दूसरे ब्लॉग्स पर लिखती हूँ, जैसे वायर हिंदी पर लिखा या जानकी पुल पर भी लिखा, लेकिन ऐसे मेरा अपना पर्सनल ब्लॉग नहीं है, मैं फेसबुक पे ही लिखती हूँ.
अच्छा, ओके. आई थिंक अब परोमिता, आई एम गोइंग टू आस्क यू वन क्वेश्चन विच हैज बीन विथ मी फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम, एंड वेदर इट इज रमाकांत रथ और देवदत्त पटनायक, एंड आई एम ट्राइंग टू थिंक ऑफ सो मेनी राइटर्स फ्रॉम ओडिशा. इज देयर एन इनहेरेंट रिलेशन बिटवीन मिथोलॉजी एंड ओडिया राइटर्स? Yeah. I have seen so many Odia writers use mythology.
That is probably an answer by itself. I don't think there is an inherent relationship, but you have left out Draupadi of Pratibhare. So it's not exactly that.
And what about your mother? Was she writing about mythology?
My mother has been a poet. I mean, she has been writing for a very long time, maybe for 50 years, and now also she is writing. She had one Kavya piece also, Shabari. Shabari is that woman in the Ramayana.
That's right. Yeah.
Waited and basically, got salvation kind of
thing.
Yeah. So it's not that. I think any kind of writer in all the languages, this happens, Rita, because in Gujarati also you must have seen, in Hindi also. Hindi, in fact, this has been written long back.
Much more, is it?
I mean, my writing on mythology rather came to Odia language much later. But in every language, writers write about that because certain characters of mythology attract them in a different way, and they affect them in a different way. And certain characters are so very relevant. As I was telling you that what I have written. So
yeah, do you want to talk about the juxtaposition you do between maybe the Tara story
even
you were
mentioning? At the point, I was thinking that what is there to write about mythological characters because so much has been written. But again and again, I had found that something is still there. You know, mythological characters are not historical characters. I think I'm correct in saying that. Those are the characters have been created by writers, intellectuals over the period and interpreted, reinterpreted, recreated. So basically, those are the set characters with the set values or, no values or, negative values or whatever, and set ideas which we try to interpret in our own way. So I believe that in a writer, in serious writing, once in a while, actually, in his period of writing would attempt at that. I believe so. So what I have been doing now, I have picked a few characters of mythology, still now women, and had tried to see their situation, what has been described in mythology, and put modern women, a modern woman, I mean, just supposed to do that. As I was discussing with you, was my first story in that series is Tara. Tara being the wife of the valiant King Bali, when Bali was killed, Tara was forcefully acquired by Sugriv. Sugriv didn't marry her. And she had to agree because of her son, Angad, who became the crown prince. And Sugriv, Ramchandra and Lakshman wanted Tara to get into this liaisonship because the banners of monkeys of Kiskinda will help them in searching for Sita, and there will be coherence in their kingdom. So I had found a modern woman who has been put in such situation where her husband exploits her to get her promotion. So like that, I mean, I don't know whether I have time to.
It's,
so this kind, even in Sita, I would like to tell you a little bit of regarding Sita, since Rakhshanda told about the Lok Katha. Actually, I was going through one Lok Katha in the translation from Kannada. In that, you know, there is an episode which I used in my thing, because I again, you know, just suppose a modern woman who has been banished by her husband. I mean, because you had gone, up pandin kaha chale gaye the, to mere ghar se nikal jao. So she meets Sita, and Sita tells her all these things. And then one episode probably, you know, like not there in Ramayana naturally, because this is from the Lok Katha, that when Sita is there in Ayodhya, and you know, she's talking to her sakhis, then they are asking, how was Ravan? How was Ravan to look at? Then she says that, I have never looked at him. Maine usko dekha nahi. Once, you know, when I was taken in the Puspak Bhiman, so I was just, you know, out of fright, out of anxiety, I looked at the water down, and I had seen some flitting, you know, flitting image of a man with, I mean, very tall and robust man with a red color of dhoti, and a lot of gold on the head, that's all. And when he was he had scolded me sometimes, a lot, and he was just going back, and I just glanced at him, and he had a, you know, he had a back like a inverted triangle, and he had a very muscular hands floating, I mean, beside him. So at that moment, she could feel that, you know, like on the doorway, Ramchandra was standing, you know, because that there is a kind of a darkness of Ramchandra's body is there.
Right.
So she stays, and so Ramchandra says that, where is Ravan? He's standing here. That is from the Lok Katha, just imagine. I mean, Lok Katha, as Jassi said, is so pervasive.
Yeah.
They write many things.
I think we literary types need to take a cue from those bestseller types. They will give you the story just about enough that you're tantalized and you want to go buy a copy, and then they'll stop there. We are so Sidha that we give the entire story away. I think I want to now come to one or two questions which have been like the bugbears of my life. And allow me to come to those questions, because I must also get something out of this panel. So I'm going to ask each of you a question about language. The language you work with, the linguistic community that you see yourself a part of, and what does it mean for you either to translate or to have somebody translate you, whether that's English or another language? But I would really appreciate if we could do this as succinctly as possible, because we are coming to the end of our session. We'll begin with you, Sudipti.
I didn't get it.
आप जिस भाषा के साथ काम करती हो, जिस जबान में लिखती हो और आगे लिखना चाहती हो और उसका और अनुवाद के साथ जो नाता है, तो आप पूरी ये भाषा की जो दुनिया है उसको आप उसमें आप अपने आप को कैसे देख रही हो?
मैं जिस भाषा में काम करती हूँ, अनुवाद उस भाषा में बहुत सारी ही चीज़ों के अनुवाद हो रहे हैं, और वो एक तरह से ये अच्छी बात है या नहीं मैं नहीं जानती, और इस पर मैं कोई बहुत जजमेंटल कमेंट भी नहीं करना चाहती हूँ, लेकिन अनुवाद की ही भाषा बनती जा रही है। जैसे उदाहरण के लिए कहें तो इसकी मूल भाषा में छपी हुई किताबें उतने लोग नहीं पढ़ते जितने की अंग्रेजी से, वही जो आप बेस्ट सेलर कह रही हैं, वो उन बेस्ट सेलर की तरह की किताबें आती हैं और उनसे कई गुना ज़्यादा पढ़ी जाती हैं। और आप किसी भी लिस्ट में देखें तो जो अनुदित किताबें हैं वो अगर 35,000-50,000 पढ़ी जाएंगी, तो मूल भाषा की किताबें जो कि पॉपुलर है वो भी 20-25,000 पढ़ी जाती हैं। तो अगर सिर्फ कोई भाषा अनुवाद की भाषा बनती जाए, या लोगों में सिर्फ चमक दमक को देखकर और अनुदित चीज़ें नाम सुनकर पढ़ने की आकांक्षा हो, तो वो भाषा की बहुत अच्छी स्थिति नहीं है। लेकिन हम हमेशा से जानते हैं कि जिस हिंदी में बहुत सारे ऐसे लेखक हुए हैं जो कि लिखते रहे हैं और बहुत अच्छी उम्दा रचनाएं हैं, और अभी भी इस पीढ़ी में भी लोग सक्रिय हैं और उनकी किताबें भी, उनकी कृतियाँ भी ट्रांसलेट हो रही हैं। जैसे मुझे याद है यहीं पर इसी जगह पर पिछले साल अकबर आई थी, और वो अंग्रेज़ी में ट्रांसलेट हो रही है, वो हिंदी में पहले आई थी। तो ये भी बहुत सारी ऐसी चीज़ें भी हो रही हैं जो पहले चीज़ें
हिंदी में आ रही। आप जब आगे और लिखने जाएंगी तो आप हिंदी या अंग्रेजी या दोनों मिलीजुली भाषा में लिखेंगी और हिंदी होगी तो किस तरह की हिंदी में आप लिखना चाहती हैं?
मैं तो हिंदी में लिखूंगी क्योंकि मेरी इस भाषा पर पकड़ है और मुझे लगता है मैं अपने तर्क और विचार इसी भाषा में ज़्यादा अच्छी तरीके से व्यक्त कर पाती हूँ। भले ही चीज़ें मैं अंग्रेज़ी की भी पढ़ती हूँ अपनी समझ बढ़ाने या जानने के लिए या जो शब्दी है, मुझे किसी भी भाषा से परहेज नहीं है, लेकिन मैं लिखूंगी तो हिंदी में। और मेरे लिखने का जो, जैसे पारमिता ने बताया कि माइथोलॉजी, मेरा अगर मैं माइथोलॉजी पे भी लिखती हूँ या मैंने पंचकन्याओं पे लिखा तो उसमें मेरा विचार मेरे ज़्यादा आते हैं, मेरे सवाल होते हैं। जैसे एक सवाल है
परोमिता की ओर जाना,
बस आखिरी बनती कि जैसे एक सवाल है, जैसे तारा की कहानी पारोमिता बता रही थी तो हम पंच कन्या में पांच कन्याएं लेते हैं, द्रौपदी, कुंती, अहल्या, तारा और मंदोदरी, और इनकी कहानी आप देखेंगे तो बार बार ये इन्होंने एक से अधिक विवाह किया या एक से अधिक बार पुरुषों से संबंध बनाए। और इसमें अहल्या ही है जिसकी कहानियों के तीन वर्जन मिलते हैं, जिसने अपनी मर्जी से, एक बार है अपनी मर्जी से, दूसरी बार है छल से, तीसरी बार है कि वो पता नहीं छल था कि अपनी मर्जी, कुछ समझ में नहीं आ रहा है। तीन जगह तीन जिक्र मिलते हैं, बाकी सब तो ऐसा था कि किसी शर्त के चलते या किसी और की मर्जी से ऐसा। तो क्या ये थोप दिया गया, क्या उन्होंने अपनी ही मर्जी की? आखिर चलते चलते ये कहानियाँ हमारे ऐसे क्यों कही जाती हैं? और फिर अगर वो कन्याएँ थीं तो फिर उनकी मर्जी की बात क्यों नहीं?
ओके, परमिता ब्रीफली प्लीज।
कमिंग बैक टू ट्रांसलेशन, आई बिलीव दैट इट्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट मीडियम फॉर ब्रिजिंग बिटवीन टू लैंग्वेजेस, कम्युनिकेशन आल्सो, बिकॉज बीइंग अ राइटर बेसिकली फ्रॉम ओडिया, आई बिलीव दैट व्हाट आई राइट शुड गो अक्रॉस, आई मीन अक्रॉस द ज्योग्राफिकल बाउंड्री ऑफ माई लैंग्वेज, एंड ट्रांसलेशन डज दैट, एंड लॉट ऑफ वर्क ऑफ ओडिया हैज बीन ट्रांसलेटेड टू अदर लैंग्वेजेस एंड हर ट्रांसलेशन नॉट बीन देयर। एज अ राइटर प्रोबेबली आई एम interested to know what other fellow writers in different languages doing, but as a reader also you have a right that you must read writers from different languages. See, if translation wasn't there, probably you would have not read Tolstoy, Marquez, Orhan Pamuk, or Gunter Grass, and so many. And now, even Tagore's Gitanjali would have not been known all over the world.
Right.
So that way, translation is very important.
Rakhshanda, I'm going to ask you a more complicated question because you've been the queen of translation. So do you see writing and translation as two separate things? Are you aware in your own head that you are engaged in one or the other?
Completely. The early lesson I learned, and I've been translating since 92, my first translation was published in 92. Very early lesson I learned was humility as a translator. This is not my text. I'm a facilitator. I am simply facilitating its accessibility from one language and literary culture into another. I have the tools at my disposal to make that transfer possible. And I do not have any humility whatsoever when it comes to other kinds of writings. It could be my own writing, my fiction writing. It could be the journalistic writing I do for newspapers and magazines where I have a point of view and I want to make it come across as clearly as possible.
Right.
But in the translations, I don't have that. Having said that, from 92 to now, I have also made a personal journey, which is from text to context. If in 92 I was perfectly content to simply translate short stories or a novel and merely provide a translator's note, a one or two page little note.
Now I feel the need to contextualize
it. And when I translated Intizar Hussain's Aage Samandar Hai, I wrote a very long introductory essay. So I do feel that now with time, I want to provide a context and I've taken that, appropriated that into my role as a translator.
Right. I'm now opening the house to questions. Yes, please. Would you tell us whom do you have want to ask the question to?
It's about mythology, so Sudipta or Paramita, maybe they can answer, but I mean, if you want to chip in, that's fine. So, sabse pehle aadab, namaste, bahut acha gyanvardhak session tha, samvad pura insightful tha. My question is, iske do pehlu hain actually. Pehla pehlu ye hai ki jo log ye insist karte hain ki Ram Bhagwan sahi mein the, Sita sahi mein thi, ye fiction nahi hai, रामायण महाभारत सब हुए, उनके लिए आपका क्या जवाब होता है इफ़ यू कम अक्रॉस सच पीपल? एंड जो दूसरा पहलू है कि क्या इसको अगर पढ़ा जाए एक सच मान के, फिक्शन मान के, या फिर पढ़ा जाए नॉन फिक्शन मान के, तो क्या इसका इंटरेस्ट, इसको अब्सॉर्ब करना, इसका जो पूरा इथॉस है इसको ग्रैब करना इजी हो जाता है या हार्ड हो जाता है अगर इसको फिक्शन या नॉन फिक्शन माना जाए? तो आप क्या चाहते हैं? मैं तो मानता हूँ कि जो है वही मान के पढ़ो, ऑब्वियसली फिक्शन है. सूरज भगवान से बच्चा हो गया, इससे ज़्यादा फिक्शन कहाँ, मतलब व्हाट इज़ देयर लेफ्ट, यू नो.
मुझे लगता है परोमिता आपके सवाल का जवाब देना चाहती हैं.
यस, चाहती हूँ. आई डोंट नो वेदर आई विल सेटिस्फाई यू और नॉट, बट हैज देयर बीन अ क्वेश्चन वेदर रामा इज करेक्ट और सीता इज करेक्ट, यू नो. ओ ओके ओके, माइट बी. सो सी, क्वेश्चंस कैन राइज एनीवेयर, एनी इन एनी फॉर्म, बट देयर इज अ दैट हैज बीन सेड, व्हाट रामायण हैज सेड. एज आई सेड दैट इट इज नॉट, टिल नाउ इट हैज नॉट बीन प्रूव्ड टू बी हिस्ट्री. It is mythology and has been told or written and rewritten and reinterpreted many, many ways. And granting that and given that we had a patriarchal society, nobody denies that at one point of time, probably the bias is towards is Ram's katha than Sita's katha. That also is true. I mean, so far. But I don't think there is, the literature actually doesn't distinguish or doesn't make a judgment who is correct, if Sita is correct, if Rama is correct. It is the life. It is basically the life that went on, and both, and Sita and Ram, both of them committed suicide. I mean, they killed themselves. That is what has happened.
I mean, मैं तो ये मानती हूँ कि जिस तरह आमतौर पर हम लोग श्रद्धा से समझते हैं कि ये सचमुच में थे या नहीं, उसी तरह एक जो लेखक है या लेखिका हैं वो भी उसी श्रद्धा से मान के चलती हैं कि थे. सवाल ये है, जब हम छोटी छोटी बिल्कुल जो बेकार की जो डिबेट्स होती हैं कि सचमुच में यहाँ थे कि या ये पहना हुआ था, कि सचमुच में ये किया था, उन छोटी जो विवादें जो खड़ी हो जाती हैं वो श्रद्धा की विवादें नहीं होती हैं, वो सिर्फ मसले होते हैं, वो सिर्फ झगड़े होते हैं, और वो राम और सीता के बारे में नहीं होते, वो हमारे बीच होते हैं जब वो इतने छोटे हो जाते हैं, इसलिए उसको हम, लेकिन जिस श्रद्धा से हम मानते हैं उसी श्रद्धा से लेखक और लेखिका भी मानते
हैं.
ओके, वी विल टेक अनदर क्वेश्चन. यस प्लीज.
थैंक यू सो मच यू ऑल. ऑफ कोर्स देयर इज नो डिसएग्रीमेंट about the indispensability of translation. But translation also needs to be accompanied by other kinds of processes of communication. For example, let us think of creating multilingual texts while translating from Oriya to English or Hindi. Is it not a necessity to create a text simultaneously in Odia and Hindi together? That means unless we accompany translation with processes of learning languages together. My second query would be that there is also an
anxiety. What was the first question?
The first question is the limits of translation. Though it is important, we would have to think of other creative ways of creating texts. For example, a text simultaneously in Odia and Hindi, and then the challenge of learning languages. The second query is that in many languages there is an anxiety of translation, and there is a hierarchy built into those who are translated into English and those who are not, for example from Odia language. So therefore, and it brings to the question of humility, Rakhyananda, I would like to ask you that how this process of translation as a journey of humility also travels with the idea of truth, not just a literal truth, but truth also is a higher order of truth.
I'll leave the Odia and Hindi bit to you, but very briefly, there are some people who believe in something called transcreation, right? I don't subscribe to that school because that takes away from the notion of humility that I want to stress. Transcreation puts the translator in a role where he feels he can create. He is also a kind of a co-creator, and he can create it in other medium. So I don't subscribe to the transcreation school. I think translator is a facilitator, is a skilled craftsman, and no more.
Actually, I have huge disagreement with Rakhshanda there, but this is not the forum where we want to do it. Other questions, please. Yes, that lady in pink.
No, but there was this. Hindi and Odia a bit left out.
So my question is directed to actually all the members of the panel. It's basically, I wanted to ask you about how much and to what extent does the presently existing stigmatization affect your writings? And how would you expect the young writers to battle it and put forth their views? Because there are certain things that the people are not very accepting towards, as in you might get slammed for writing as a pro-feminist or by leftist or writers. So how do you expect the young generation to battle things like that when they're writing?
I think I'll ask Paramita and Sukriti maybe to respond. Paramita, do you want to?
Basically, you want to know what leanings should a young writer have? Do you want? And what does
she says if you are assaulted with labels and categories and people are saying, oh, they're slamming your work.
Yes.
Then she says, as to a young writer, how would you say how to defend yourself and to stand your ground, right? I think that's what you're asking.
No, actually, every writer has a conviction. That has to be allowed to him or her. You know, only that there should not be too much of bias, too much of, you know, like basically your writing or a creative writing is a piece of art. Imagination and art put together. So basically, creative writing has been fiction. We are talking about literature. I am talking about that only, creative writing and fiction. So in fiction, you have imagination and art and your conviction. Three things go together. So I believe that when you are a creative writer, probably there should not be any leanings or should not be any bias. So while describing lives, while describing incidents, while describing things that had happened or are happening or are going to happen, you have to be very clear in your mind what you are writing.
I think you've got to be courageous and stick your neck out.
That you have to be that. That you have to have it in you. Okay.
And Shamaila,
please.
हमेशा से ऐसा रहा है कि जब भी आप लिखते हैं तो लिखना एक साहस की मांग करता है जैसे जब तुलसीदास रामचरितमानस लिख रहे थे आज उनके नाम पे लोग लड़ाई कर सकते हैं लेकिन तब भी उनके लिए साहस की बात थी क्योंकि बहुत सारे पंडितों ने कह दिया कि संस्कृत को छोड़कर राम की कहानी किसी और भाषा में नहीं लिखी जा सकती है जब कालिदास ने शिव और पार्वती के प्रेम कहानी लिखी तो बहुत सारे मठाधीशों ने उनका भी विरोध किया तो लिखना हमेशा ही साहस की मांग करता है और अगर आपको अपने लिखे के प्रति यकीन है ईमानदारी है साहस है तो लिखना पड़ता है
Yeah, I think so. Yes.
Good evening. My name is Muhammad Ali, and my one very fine question is that if we look up.
आप किसके लिए सवाल पूछना चाहें? Whom are you?
Ma'am.
Paramita?
Yeah, ma'am.
Achha, ठीक.
My question is that ki khas taur, can I speak in.
Yes, you can. Just take the mic closer to your mouth, please.
It is better I should ask in Hindi, I think. लोगों को लगता है लोगों को लगता है कि हिंदुस्तान में आके भी अगर अंग्रेज चले गए तो अंग्रेजी में बात करो क्यों ना हिंदी में बात की जाए पोस्ट कॉलोनियल
नहीं नहीं आप हिंदी में पूछिए बेशक
आप हिंदी में
सब समझते हैं
आई रिस्पेक्ट एवरी लैंग्वेज बट आई थिंक वो एक हिंदुस्तानी है तो झलकनी चाहिए अगर हम लोग जयपुर में हम लोग हिंदुस्तान में तो पता तो लगना चाहिए कि हिंदुस्तान में
नहीं वो तो जैसे कि मैं अभी अभी बोली कि हमारे 24 लैंग्वेजेस है 24 भाषाएं हैं और मैं उड़ीसा की हूँ मैं उड़िया में लिखती हूँ मैं हिंदी समझती हूँ हिंदी में कुछ कुछ बात कर सकती हूँ लेकिन हम अपनी मन की भाव बहुत अच्छी तरह से हिंदी में प्रकाश नहीं कर पाती हूँ इसीलिए मैं अंग्रेजी का आश्रय लेती हूँ तो इट्स बेसिकली यू नो लाइक क्लिंगिंग टू अ लैंग्वेज बट माई द लैंग्वेज आई ड्रीम इन इज उड़िया That is also a Hindustani language.
Of course, it is an official language in the Constitution of India. My question is that कि अगर आप post-colonial मतलब 1947 के बाद देखें भारत में जो भी institutions बने हैं उनको कहीं ना कहीं अंग्रेजी के इर्द गिर्द ही बुन दिया गया है और भारत की राष्ट्रीय भाषा को केवल एक दिवस 14 नवंबर को बनाने देने से नहीं हो जाता है तो क्या और दूसरा प्रश्न ये है कि हिंदी की प्रमाणिकता पे हमेशा शक क्यों होता है कोई भी आप किताब खरीदने जाएं अगर इंग्लिश है तो लोग सोचते हैं यार इसमें राइट चीज़ मिल जाएगी सच्ची घटना होगी अगर हिंदी में होती कहीं ना कहीं आदमी शक क्यों करता है कि इसमें ये प्रमाणिक नहीं होगी ऐसी क्या वजह है क्या हमारी सोच गलत है या माहौल गलत है व्हाट इज़ योर पॉइंट ऑन मैम यू कैन राइट आंसर
पहली बात तो कि 14 नवंबर नहीं मेरे ख्याल से 14 सितंबर होता है लेकिन कोई बात नहीं ये तो तथ्यात्मक गलतियां हैं जो हिंदी भाषा की किताबों में आप आरोप लगा रहे हैं कि होती है दरअसल दिक्कत ये है कि जब तक आप कह रहे हैं कि संस्थाएं जब तक हम सरकारी संस्थाओं या संस्थाओं के भरोसे रहेंगे जब हमें अपने भाषा के लिए प्यार नहीं रहेगा हम उसमें ज्ञान विज्ञान की चीज़ें खुद नहीं पढ़ना चाहेंगे तब कैसे काम बात बनेगी अगर पाठक जाकर कहेगा कि मैं यह किताब हिंदी में ही पढ़ना चाहता हूँ तो वो किताब क्यों नहीं आएगी? क्योंकि किताब बेचने वाला हमेशा बाज़ार में बेचने के लिए उतरता है और उसको लगेगा नहीं, हिंदी में पढ़ के तो लगता है कि समझ नहीं आ रहा है, अंग्रेज़ी ही ठीक है, तो क्यों वो फिर एफर्ट करेगा लाने की? तो अगर आप सोशल साइंस की या बाकी चीज़ों की किताबों की बात कर रहे हैं जिसमें ज्ञान विज्ञान की बातें, जो सिर्फ रचनाएं नहीं है, फिक्शन नहीं है, जिसमें सिर्फ कथा कहानी नहीं है, तो उनकी तो पाठकीयता बढ़े, उनकी मांग बढ़े, तभी कोई लिखेगा और छपेगा। और दूसरी बात कि लोगों को भी अपनी तरफ से काम करना पड़ेगा, सिर्फ सरकार राजभाषा बना देगी तो वो एक पखवाड़े की ही भाषा रहेगी जिसमें लोग जाके श्राद्ध कराएंगे।
एक सेशन अभी हुआ था शशि थरूर के साथ हिंदी और अंग्रेजी वाला, शायद ये कुछ सवाल शायद वहाँ ज़्यादा ठीक रहते हैं या वहीं से आए हुए हैं, लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि ये हम बहुभाषीय हैं, बहुत सारी भाषाएं हैं, अगर आप हायरार्की देखने जाएं तो हिंदी ज़रूर, ये ज़रूर है कि अंग्रेज़ी की जगह कुछ और ही बन चुकी है जो दुख की बात है, लेकिन हिंदी की जगह भी काफ़ी ऊँची है। आप दूसरी भाषाओं के साथ तुलना करें तो अब तो किसी कुछ भाषाओं के तो नंबर ही नहीं लगते, ऑफिशियल भाषाएं नहीं बनती, उनको तो बोली कहा जाता है, उनको डायलेक्ट कहा जाता है। तो ये जो पूरा जो सिलसिला है बहुत पुराना है और उसकी तो लंबी कतार लगी हुई है। मुझे लगता है अब हम सेशन ख़त्म करें क्योंकि हमारे पास अगर सवाल का वक्त है लेकिन उसके जवाब का वक्त नहीं होगा। सो प्लीज़ अलाउ मी
सेंटेंस आई वांट टू ऐड कि यू नो रीडेबिलिटी ऑफ अ बुक डिपेंड्स ऑन रीडर्स। अगर रीडर्स लेंगे हिंदी ओडिया सब उर्दू पढ़ेंगे तो शायद वो किताब छपेगी और बिकेगी और हम लोगों को भी अच्छा लगेगा एज अ राइटर की हमारी किताब आप लोग पढ़ रहे हैं।
ठीक है, और खुशी खुशी पैनल ख़त्म करेंगे तो मुझे भी अच्छा लगेगा। आई विल हैव टू स्टॉप हियर एंड थैंक यू ऑल वेरी मच फॉर दिस वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग डिस्कशन। थैंक यू कॉलीग्स।
Thank you so much, Sudipti, Paramita, Rakhshanda, and Rita Kothari. It was lovely having you here.